next song you have, we're going to, on to Johnny
Johnny Halliday.
Halliday.
Now, anyone listening is unfamiliar with Johnny Halliday. He was he just died about 3 years ago. He was probably died about age 84. He or 82, whatever. He was known, labeled quickly as the French Elvis. He was a rock and roll guy. He did a lot of movies, French, and sings in French. And I've always, because I love Elvis so much, and we'll get to Elvis, I'm going to close the show with Elvis.
Okay.
Right? We'll get to Elvis. I wanted to see him, and Jane Rothchild, my beloved Jane, who's with me today, I said, Jane, we're going to go see Johnny Halliday. And you let out a sound. I had never heard you make that. Like, well, I had heard it a couple of times, but not over verbally like that. But anyway, the this song, I Who Have Nothing, was originally an Italian song. And Lieber and Stoller wrote the English lyrics, and Tom Jones had a substantial hit with it. So it's the only English song that Johnny sang that night at the Beacon Theater. And this song, and this is a live recording of it, is the single greatest live performance of anything I've ever seen. It's Johnny and one of his backup singers coming forward. And
Amy Keys, right?
Amy, in a, somewhere like in about halfway through the song, three quarters, it was like the whole audience levitated and went nuts.
Really?
Yeah, so for your consideration, let's go to the Beacon Theater and see if Johnny Halliday can levitate you. And oh, by the way, the words are pretty good, too.
All
here
right.
We go.
Get ready to be levitated. I like that.
Yeah. Wow.
That's an amazing duo. Seriously, that's a great song. I see the inspiration there, Bill.
Yeah, that'll pull you out of bed in the morning.
Don't you think?
Well, or put you in bed at night.
You were saying you were using that in order to get out of bed after a double hip operation.
Yeah, but actually, that's it. Thanks, Bill. I was thanks for reminding everybody that both my hips are replaced so that anybody wants to chase me down the street is going to catch me.
It's okay. I had a knee replacement. I totally get it.
Yeah. So I was in rehab for 10 days, having had both hips replaced. The first operation of my life, I went for it big. Do both hips at the same time. And so I'm at rehab, and in order to get to sleep at night, they gave you pills. I had my own supply.
Right, of course.
Always be prepared with drugs. I had my own supply. And so when I woke up in the morning, my God, I could hardly get out of bed. Yeah. And that song and a couple of others I would play just to get myself literally
motivated.
Get the blood flowing. Yep. You know, it's anyway.
I like that a lot.
Thank you.
So we're going to pivot now because I'm dying
important.
To know.
You can do that with these hips.
I want to. Because you have the new hips, you can pivot. Because I so want to hear from you, Jane.
Thank you. First of all,
tell me about your life, career, how you met up with this guy.
Oh, that's a long story.
All right, so we have time.
Oh. We got time.
You have time. Well, Bill and I have been together 11 years. And interestingly enough, I worked in TV. My first job out of college, I was working for Johnny Carson.
Oh, wow.
And then I got involved in game shows. And
worked with Dick Clark.
I worked with me. I produced $20,000 pyramids. So the funny thing would be Bill and I were traveling in the same circles, but we honestly had never met.
Keep going.
Sorry, that's Nala.
Nala needs a microphone.
That's our audience.
That's so funny. Can we just close
the door? Not Spike the Wonder Dog. That's all I have to say.
We're closing the door so we don't hear Nala.
Okay,
just wait a second.
Well, she's quiet now.
So, no, I want to hear more, though. So, $20,000 pyramid, you played, you...
I was the producer.
Seriously?
Yeah. I won two Emmy Awards. But the funny thing would be, like, I'd be with Dick Clark during the day because he hosted the show.
Yeah.
And then it turned out... after Bill and I met, I found out Bill would be with him at night.
Yeah, Dick and I dated for many years.
Anyway.
Oh, there you go. There's a question. Things that Dick Clark would say on a date.
Well, that Jane Rothchild is hot. Whoa.
What else? This pyramid show that they redid, did you like the revamped version of it?
Honestly, I don't watch it.
Okay, there
it's
you
too
go.
Difficult for me.
Yeah.
Right, yeah,
it's really difficult. It just brings back. First of all, I was the judge. I produced it, and I wrote all the categories and the words.
I did.
And I'd be in the control room, and I was the buzzer.
All right, Jane. Here's the deal.
Yeah.
We're gonna have a game night at my house.
Yes.
And you're gonna be on my team. Okay.
Okay.
How much fun would that be?
Fabulous.
We are doing a game night.
I love the $20,000 pyramid.
I am so in.
You better bring your $20,000.
I have the box set. Oh. I have it.
I'm telling you.
The original.
No. We're going to make this happen like soon.
I'd love that.
I'm so excited.
Never missed that show. I love that show. And I'll never forget on the final round where, you know, they get the big money.
Yeah.
The $20,000 pyramid.
Right.
Somebody won and got it on like the last second, and it seemed like to me it was Sammy Davis or somebody who was the celebrity host. They jumped. They ran and they jumped over the chairs.
Exactly.
You know, it's two chairs that face each other.
Yes. I remember that.
So excited, they leapt over the chairs.
And I'm like, this.
Oh my God, that actor could have broke both legs.
Exactly.
They were so excited.
So funny. It was so exciting. I mean, I loved it. It was a great part of my life.
And did you also, have you seen the Saturday Night Live skits from that show?
Yes.
Oh my God, come on. They're so good when she's, who is it? What's the actress? And she goes, you know, they say, things bought in a grocery store or whatever. And she goes, okay, all right, okay. And the timer starts and she goes, things bought in a grocery store.
It is
so funny.
Funny, Bill and I were at an event at Guildhall a couple of years ago and ran into Dick Cavett,
who
was on the show a lot. And I reminded Dick that I was the judge. He went, and he remembered a category. He said, you buzz me. And I wish I could remember it now. You buzz me.
He did remember it, though.
It was an illegal.
My God, I love that.
Oh, is that right?
It was part of the title of a book, and it just wasn't.
He didn't say the right answer.
Oh, the pit and the pendulum.
Exactly.
Oh, no, what it was? I just remembered it. It was.
serving the East End and Connecticut since 1963. Okay. We're live and local.
Okay, I was trying to get the sound.
Don't try this at home. We usually tell people don't try this at home, but folks,
that
try this at home.
So funny. All right, so sorry.
So the category was things with a pit.
Oh, things with a pit. Okay.
Like a peach, you know, yes. Apricot.
Yes.
He says a pendulum.
And that doesn't have a pit.
I know, the pit and the pendulum. So it was an
But this is Dick Cavett. Come on. I know.
There you go. Thank you, Bill.
So I gave him that buzzer.
All right, I'm sorry that we even brought it up because Bill now loves to play Bill.
Well, anyway, this is just going back, reliving things, but there are so many stories.
I love that.
Yes.
Exactly. So tell me something. I know we've got the Nielsen song up. You had a good story about John Lennon.
Yeah, well, back in those days, so it was in the mid-70s. It was after John was with May Pang. So he'd gone back to Yoko. Right.
Okay.
So
okay.
Whenever that was, I was in my late 20s, and I'm working on Pyramid.
May's still a big listener of our show and on our social media pages and all that stuff.
Okay, I won't say anything. Yeah. Oh, too late, I said something. Yeah. Anyway, it was a Sunday morning, and I lived on West 71st between Broadway and West End Avenue.
Okay.
It was one of those days, as a woman, you could relate, you know, Jessica, you look like crap, you're exhausted. And back then, they had double features. So there was a movie theater on 72nd and Broadway, and I didn't even care what they were playing. I just wanted to get out of the apartment, threw on a sweatshirt, no makeup, my hair was frizzy, and just I wanted the day to pass.
Yes.
And so I get to the movie, and the first movie's over, then the second movie is about 10 minutes from ending.
Yeah.
And in walks three people who sit next to me, and I turn around and look, and right next to me on my left is John Lennon. And I couldn't. I was in shock. And John immediately turns to me. The theater wasn't that crowded. And he says, "So what did we miss?" I said, "What did you miss? You missed everything. The movie's about to end."
You idiot, John Lennon.
Didn't you remember the movie?
No.
You don't remember the movie.
I don't remember that movie. But John says at that point, the movie ends, and he turns to me and he says, "Well, what else is playing in the neighborhood?" And that I remember was the Three Musketeers.
Okay.
Oh, my God.
So the Three Musketeers were playing at the Beacon Theater where we saw Johnny Holiday, funny.
Years later.
So John turns to Yoko, and this man who I didn't recognize.
Yeah.
And you want to go see the Three Musketeers? They said, yeah. And John says, come with us. We'll go see the Three Musketeers.
Stop it.
So I just am in total shock. I'm like floating. It's like I levitated.
Yes, exactly.
I wasn't walking. I floated to the two blocks to the Beacon Theater, and then I am seated between this man who I don't know, John Lennon, and then Yoko's on the other side of John.
Yeah.
I didn't see a second of the movie. I can't tell you a thing that happened.
Okay.
I was just in shock. The movie ends. We all walk out like we're old friends. We're now walking to the Dakota. I can't believe it. And we're chatting, and I still don't know who the guy is that I'm talking to. But all of a sudden, I notice he's wearing a necklace, and the necklace says, Schmiel. Nielsen. I went, oh my God, wait a second. Are you Nielsen Schmielsen?
Yes!
And he says, yes. I said, oh my God, I just can't believe it. I didn't. It turned out my cousin Tina was worked on that album, so I knew about it.
Amazing.
So Harry said, I said, my name is Jane, and Harry says to John, this is Tina's cousin Jane. So we walked John and Yoko to the Dakota, and then Harry said, let's go have dinner, and we did. So that's one of my stories.
And so here we've got Nielsen's song, Everybody's Talking.
Okay, good.
I love this. That is a great story. Thank you, Jane.
Midnight Cowboy.
Yes.
Everybody's talking at me. I don't hear words they're saying. Only the echoes of my mind. People stopping still. I can't see their faces. Only the shadows of their eyes. I'm going where the sun keeps shining through the pouring rain. Going where the weather suits my clothes. skipping over the ocean like a stone. Everybody's talking at me, can't hear a word they're saying, only the echoes of my mind. I won't let you leave my love behind. No, I won't let you leave.
Hello, this is Julie Andrews. There is nothing I like more than a good cup of tea and listening to Jessica Ambrose and Bill Evans on Lunch on the Deck on 92.1 WLNG.
You're walking along the street, you're at a party, or else you're alone and then you suddenly dig. You're looking in someone's eyes, you suddenly realize that this could be the start of something big. You're lunching at 21, watching your diet, declining a Charleroi's, accepting a fig. When out of a clear blue sky, it's suddenly gallon guy, and this could be the start of something big. There's no controlling the unrolling of your fate, my friend. Who knows what's written in the magic book? But when a lover you discover at the gate, my friend, invite her in without a second look. You're up in an aeroplane, or dining at Sardi's, or lying at Malibu, alone in the sand. You suddenly hear a bell, and can tell that this could be the start of something grand. You're doing your income tax, or buying a toothbrush, or hurrying home because the hour is late. Then suddenly there you go, the very next thing you know is this could be the start of something great. You're having a snowball fight, or picking up daisies, you're singing a happy tune, or knocking on wood. When all of a sudden you look up and there's someone new, oh, this could be the start of something good. Your destined lover you discover in a frightening flash, so keep your heart awake both night and day, because the meeting may be fleeting as a lightning flash, and you don't want to let it slip away. Watching the sun come up, or counting your money, or else in a dim cafe, you're ordering wine. Then suddenly there she is, you want to be where she is. And this must be the start of something, this could be the heart of something, this could be the start of something grand.
WLNG. I love that. That was Jack Jones. And I want to come, you're going to come back though. We've got to hear more from you because I want to hear about your relationship. Who did you meet?
Which time?
You said, I know. We were
she's
just
a
talking.
Single woman in the 70s.
No. We were just talking how
meet?
You met someone or something.
Bill? How
no.
I met Bill.
Yes.
That's a long story. Yeah, I picked him up in a
restaurant. It's too long.
You did not.
Basically, I picked him up in a restaurant.
That's a short story.
Well, that's what I actually wanted to play. This could be the start of something big. Because Jane picked me up in a restaurant. I got her card. And 3 weeks later, I called her. And what did we do?
We went to Bemelman's Bar.
And
it was
the start of 11 years.
But interestingly enough, speaking of hips, that was on November 5th.
Speaking of hips.
November 5th,
I think
Friday.
We know why he had a hip replacement.
Because I said to him, I'd love to go out with you, but I'm having my hip replaced on Wednesday.
What am I getting involved in?
There's a pickup line.
No, I'd like to wear out my hips on you, baby.
Exactly. Wait a minute. You were getting your hip done.
In 2010.
Okay.
When Bill and I, when I picked up, honestly, Bill, but we were at a restaurant called Osteria del Cerco.
Oh, okay. Sure.
5th Street.
Yeah.
And Bill was there with a friend. And I was on my way to the Manhattan Theater Club to a 7 o'clock curtain. I was alone. And I sat down kind of close to them because they were two good-looking men. And I'm not stupid. So I ordered a vodka tonic. And I'm listening to them. They're having fun. And then Mauro, the owner's son, comes out. And Bill gets up and embraces him.
Yeah.
And Bill's friend John says, by the way, have you heard that Bill's available again?
Now, I want to quickly point out, he said this because he had an instinct that the woman sitting behind us was the right woman for me. And as a result of his saying that, Jane heard it.
I heard it. I looked on my watch. It was 20 to 7. Kurt and I've never been shy. So I just stood up. I took I was limping because my hip is killing me.
I did limp,
and I leaned in between the two men, and I said, "Gentlemen, I did not mean to eavesdrop, but I couldn't help it over here that Bill, that you, I hadn't recognized Bill by then, that you are available. So am I." Well, Bill's mouth opened in a... He was aghast. You know, it was just... John stood up. He's 6'7", pulled out a chair, said, "You are fabulous. Sit right down." He went over and got my vodka tonic, got my purse. And I sat with them until 6:58, just having fun.
Oh, how funny.
And you just said, "Hey, we're both having our hips done. So we've got something in common."
That's very funny.
That's the new pickup line.
How long was it before he called you?
3 weeks. Honestly, his mom had... He had buried his mom 2 days before we met.
I personally buried my mother. A lot of people don't do that. It's just a shovel. It buried my others buried her.
It takes a while.
Yeah.
That's why you had to have your hips done.
And we were together ever since.
But did you ever think in the 3 weeks that you weren't going to hear from him?
Yeah. The first week I was sure that I would. Truthfully, I was sure I would. I became homebound because I couldn't walk. I was getting my hip replaced.
Yeah.
So I thought I would hear from him, and then I gave up. And then suddenly he called 3 weeks later on a Friday.
Yeah, it was Friday night. And I was really in the mood to go out and have a couple drinks and hear some music. And I thought, I'll call that woman from Chirco. And fortunately, hadn't lost her card.
Which is
otherwise,
a miracle.
Yeah. Otherwise, we would not be here. And we went, that's why I wanted to play. This could be the start of something big. Boom, there we were. And we've been together ever since.
I love that story.
Well, you need a crooner like Peter Allen, actually.
Yeah, Peter Allen. I met Peter Allen back in Chicago in around 66 when I was... with the comedy team and doing a show out there. And Peter Allen was performing at Mr. Kelly's. And I met him. This is before he married Liza or anybody. And so Peter Allen and I had known each other from 66. And we saw our careers grow. And he was on Midday and other shows I did several times. There's a nice long interview with him on Bill Boggs TV on YouTube, Peter Allen. Anyway, this song, Continental American, takes me right back into the heart of the decadent but tremendously enjoyable disco time of 77, 78, 79. Continental American paints a picture of what life was like for a lot of us back then.
So high, we could never come down. When rules did not apply, we would dream. sound. And bands that play to please me. Whoa. You found a partner easy. Whoa. The name game was the only
WLNG 92.1 WLNG. Did I say that already?
Yeah,
Lunch
you did.
On the deck.
That was it's, like repetitive.
It's gotten to that point.
Deja vu all over again.
You just wait. I just completely. Anyway. All right.
Jessica and Bill and our very special guests, Bill Boggs and Lady Jane Rothschild.
Yeah, I just love meeting you guys. I have a feeling this is just the beginning of something
big.
This is the start of something big.
We hope so also.
What I want, we're an hour and a half into the show, and we really haven't discussed... Although we discussed the music, and you have wonderful pick of music, but I want you to tell people about what you've done in your career, because I think what you've done in your career is amazing. I'm a 30-year guy of doing one thing, 47 years of doing one thing total. Yeah. But you have done a lot of stuff. I mean, you produced boxing.
No, I hosted boxing.
Hosted boxing.
I was executive producer of the Morton Downey Jr. Show.
Right.
The beginning of trash TV, like that guy Jim Cramer on Mad Money.
Yeah.
When I interviewed him for the other book, Got What It Takes, he said, I'm powdering my whole show on Morton Downey, like screaming into the camera and stuff like that. And then we did, I had a production company. Richard Baker and I did rock shows with Lou Reed, Ian Hunter, Mink DeVille, Bobby Short at the Cafe Carlisle, Frank Zappa.
Yep.
And then we produced a show that's syndicated in 120 stations. I was a host and co-executive producer called Comedy Tonight, which took me back into how I started in the business, comedy. And Comedy Tonight had, we literally auditioned 1,526 comedians for the seasons, and we had 456 comedians during the course of.
Stop. So I run into guys. Wow. Kind of painful.
Whoopi was on the show.
Oh, really?
Some have made it. Some have fallen by the wayside.
So some of it was a little painful to listen to.
Oh, sure, like that. I'm a domestic goddess.
Actually, what we did was Richard and I auditioned them. We picked the bits, like do the thing about the guy and the toll taker.
Okay.
Do the thing about the deli, but cut it by 30 seconds.
Okay.
So we had all the material timed out. So we never put anybody on whom we didn't want. Dangerfield was on the show. It's a really
On to the Food Channel.
Yeah, after when I left Midday after 12 years, I was glad to end it. You know, there things end.
And yeah.
It was very repetitious. So basically, I was like an adventure that I started, and I was on WNBC as an anchor and live at 5. But because of my interest in food and my girlfriend at the time, Ishbel, who was a chef, we did a little radio show on Saturdays out of Greenwich, Connecticut. And I heard the Food Network was coming on, and I went and pitched myself, which is, again, what you got to do in the business.
Right.
You don't sit back. You call and say, I'll do the weather for free.
I was on WGCH doing the weather at the time you guys had that show.
Yeah.
That was a great show.
Yes,
Let's eat.
It was a total show. So, yeah, then I insinuated myself onto the Food Network and did a show called Bill Boggs Corner Table, which was a scam.
I remember that.
Here's why it's a scam. I got the Food Network to pay me really good money to go to the greatest restaurants in America, sit down
and
with
eat for
big
free.
Name celebrities, eat for free, and be on television. They paid me to have lunch with Sophia Loren.
Have a conversation with Colin Ambrose. God. We are going to do something here food-wise.
Okay.
That would be so awesome.
Yeah. Food and music, great passions.
Okay, good. I like it.
And now I'm focusing on, essentially, if someone would call me to do TV, I'm 80 years old. If someone would call me to do TV, I would say, I'll take the job. But I've been chasing work and getting it all my life. So 5 years ago, I said, I'm going to write satire. I started in comedy, and The Adventures of Spike the Wonder Dog with the memoiristic overtones is the result of that.
Yeah.
That book is good.
Satirical book.
So talk to me. We've got Bobby Darin, The Good Life.
Oh, well, go back to 1963. Tony Bennett sings, It's a Good Life. Right. To me, at the time, that was,
free. You're not a singer. That's what you're trying to say. No.
Demonstration is everything. I was trying to sing like Tony Bennett. Yeah, Bill. That was a good song. Anyway, it's a good life to be free and explore the unknown. I interpreted the song as that's what it was. But it wasn't until I heard the Bobby Darin rendition to this did I realize that this is a sardonic, mean song where the guy is saying, hey, if you don't stay with me, kiss the good life goodbye. So listen to this from that perspective. Darren delivers the goods. The closest you can see to Bobby Darin working these days is Bobby Rydell. He's a great singer. But here's Darin in The Good Life.
Oh, the good life, full of fun, seems to be the ideal. Yes, the good life lets you hide all the sadness you feel. You won't really fall in love, for you can't take the chance. So be honest with yourself, don't try to fake romance. It's the good life to be free and explore the unknown. Like the heartaches when you learn you must face them alone. Please remember, I still want you. And in case you wonder why, well, just wake up and kiss that good life goodbye. It's the good life to be free and still want you. And in case you wonder why, well, just wake up and kiss that good life goodbye.
I won't be long.
Nice. 92.1 WLNG.
You won't be wrong. Why stop now?
Exactly.
why don't go short now.
Okay.
We're going into Frank Sinatra. You got to intro Frank Sinatra.
Well, Frank Sinatra's a big part of my life. And people will say, what's your favorite Sinatra song? Well, Sinatra recorded 1,500 songs. I think I have all of them. And this essentially is my theme song. It's my favorite Sinatra song. It's Sinatra really doing a rhythm and blues in a way. It's live at Carnegie Hall, and it's telling you what you need to do in your life, as music informs us sometimes about how to live, about how to get yourself up, and pick yourself up, and get back in the race. That's life.
I love it.
Say you're riding high in April, shot down in May. Soon I'm gonna change that tune. When I'm back on top this coming June, yeah, that's life. And strange as it may seem, I know a couple of folks who get their kicks stomping on dreams. But I ain't never gonna let it get me down, because this crazy old world keeps going around. I've been a piper, a poet, a pauper, a peasant, a pawn, and a king. I've been up and down and over and out, and I know one thing. Each time I find myself laying there on my face, I get myself up and get back. You ever deny it? I was gonna leave town last week, baby, but my heart wouldn't buy it. However, if I didn't think it was worth one try,
Did you get any on you in the band at all? I'm gonna roll myself up in a big ball and fly. My.
You know, you never can go wrong with a little Frank Sinatra, right?
Right. You can go. You can't go wrong with Frank.
No, never.
Absolutely not. But that's my theme song. That's life.
Now, I'll tell you my Frank Sinatra story.
Let's hear it.
Years ago, I used to go play a lot of golf in the desert, Palm Springs. So I get invited to go to Morningside, a country club that's right next to Thunderbird, where I was a member. And so we go to Morningside, and I go in there, and there's a million pictures of Frank Sinatra in the lounge, the bar, the grill, the main cafeteria. And I go, wow, what's it with Frank? And they said, well, and even the golf course is on Frank Sinatra Way and Morningside Drive. So I go in, I go, what's the deal with Frank? This is great. They go, well, we asked Frank when we were building the golf course if he would be a member, because we wanted a really big name, because Thunderbird had Bob Hope and Bing Crosby, and they had everybody. So they wanted a big name. So they invited Frank, and Frank came and looked at the layout of the course as they were building it, and he said, you're not building these bathrooms on the course above ground, are you? And they said, no, we're not. They didn't know what to say. He's asking about bathrooms.
Where would you like them, Frank?
So he said, well, I don't like above-ground bathrooms on a golf course. And so they built three of the most immaculately beautiful bathrooms underground at this golf course. You would never know they're there.
Along the course, like a bunker.
They're beautiful stone entrances, and you go in, and in the bathrooms, it's glass and marble.
Wow.
And they're absolutely gorgeous.
Whistling Straits. Yes. Underground, too. They
spent more money on the bathrooms than they did on the course.
Yes. That's a great story.
But Frank became a member.
Oh my gosh. All right, we've got another Frank Sinatra coming up with Sammy Davis, but first, I wanted to play this Platters.
Well, The Great Pretender by the Platters. Being from Philadelphia, I got to know Dick Clark, and Jane worked with Dick Clark many years later. And Dick, in an interview with him in Philadelphia, which is on Bill Boggs TV, the YouTube channel, which is free, so you can reference it, I asked Dick if you could, and this interview was like 1987, if you could take 1 year of music, one little spot group, what would you take, and whose voice would you take? And he said, oh, no one ever asked me. And he thinks, I would pick 56. And he goes on about 56. And I said, and whose voice? And he said, the voice of Tony Williams, the lead singer of the Platters, is the best voice I've ever heard.
The Platters, 92.1 WLNG with a lunch on the deck with our guest, Bill Boggs. Oh, no, you just wait your turn there, Frank. yeah, I need you to cue this song up for me.
Okay, so Sammy, go ahead.
No, I was going to say which song we were going to go to because you have a Sammy and a Frank together.
Frank and Sammy together, me and my shadow. Mm-hmm. Frank and Sammy and Dean released a single. And the one side was Frank and Sammy doing Me and My Shadow. The other was Sam's songs. And Jane's cousin, Sammy Kahn, wrote special lyrics, which we're going to hear with Me and My Shadow. But the reason I picked this is we were talking about the power of music to energize you.
Right.
This is not an unknown thing. And I have 5 stage shows I do. It all started at Triad Theater when I was doing Talk Show Confidential, and now that's Confessions of a Talk Show. So I have Memories of Sinatra, I have Rat Pack Revisited, I've done a couple of Guildhall, and I do them at colleges and stuff. And this song, Me and My Shadow, right before I'm introduced, like with this is what I play in my head twice. And there's something about this song, and only me referring it to it this way, it takes me back to these great performers, Frank and Sammy. It takes me back to them on stage, the tradition of going out there on stage and delivering the goods. So this is what I played every single night at the Triad Theater right before I was introduced. I played Me and My Shadow.
Like the wallpaper sticks to the wall,
like shark clings to the sea,
like you'll never get rid of your shadow, Frank, you'll never get rid of me.
Let all the others fight and fuss,
whatever happens, we've got us. We're closer than pages that stick
and
in a book. We're closer than ripples that play in a brook.
Strolling
wherever you'll find him, you'll find me, just look. Closer than a miser or the bloodhound's Deliza, me.
We're closer than smog when it clings
and
to L.A. We're closer
shadow
than Bobby is to JFK. Not a soul can bust this team in two. We stick together like glue. And
that's when we rise.
We start to swing.
Swing to the sky.
Our clocks don't chime.
What a surprise.
They ring.
A ding ding. A happy new year.
Me.
And now to repeat what I said
and
at the start.
My shadow.
They'll need a large crowbar to break us apart. We're alone, but
finished, we'll make the town roar. We'll make all the late spots and then a few more. We'll wind up at Jilly's right after Toots Shore.
Life is gonna be a wee wow wee
for my shadow and me.
Say, Frank.
What is it, Sam?
Would you do me a favor?
What do you want now?
Would you mind just taking it one more time?
From the top?
No, from the ending.
Wonderful.
And while we are swinging, to mention a few, we're dropping at Danny's, the little club too. But wind up at Jilly's, whatever we do.
Yeah,
life is gonna be a wee wow.
WLNG. I love, I just love hearing them talk, right? To hear them talking to each other on that song.
When Frank goes, what now, Sammy?
Exactly. They're so cute.
Forget about it. Okay.
Exactly. Yeah. Great song choice. All right, now we're going to go, not Tommy Edwards, we're going to go right into another Frank.
Yeah, Look to Your Heart, lyrics by Jane's cousin, Sammy Kahn. If you go back to 1955, Producers Showcase on live television did Thornton Wilder's Our Town, and Sinatra was the narrator, the stage manager. Paul Newman and Eva Marie Saint were on this live production. So Kahn and Van Heusen wrote a score, so there were seven songs from that show. And did I say On the Town? That's not what I meant.
What'd you mean?
I meant the Thornton Wilder play.
Our Town.
One of the songs is You Will Like the Folks You Meet in Our Town. Thank you. Anyway, this song, Look to Your Heart, is from there. And there were certain lyrics that Sammy Kahn wrote that I think are literally instructing you, like Come Blow Your Horn or All the Way, telling you like a way to live. Mm-hmm. But Look to Your Heart is, I think, more relevant than ever before. So listen to the words and listen to what Sammy, through Frank, through that live broadcast, is saying to us.
WLNG with Lunch on the Deck with my least favorite part of the show, because it's time for us to say goodbye.
Yeah, we hate that.
We hate that, yeah. Bill always, you guys will leave and Bill will have to bring me back together again because I cry.
We get therapy the last hour of the show.
Well, it's mutual,
Just so you know, when you're in your car, we're going to be sitting here going, and wasn't that fun when they played that?
Yeah.
And then when he said that...
Yeah, we have to have a debriefing.
Well, we'll be in the car listening, so...
We will debrief.
Say nice things.
Exactly, we will.
Did he make sense, really, though? Was he really...
Yeah, you guys were awesome.
So I'm so sorry, because one of the things we had planned for you was a secret call-in from an old friend of yours...
Who would that be?
...who didn't call in.
Who was that?
Michael Carenti.
Oh, Michael, wow.
He's the godfather.
Is he out here now?
No, he's in Rhode Island.
Providence.
He's my youngest daughter's godfather. And my husband and I were talking the other day, and he goes, who's your guest this week? And I said, Bill Boggs. And he said, oh, my God, you got to get Michael on the air.
I love that guy.
Isn't he so funny? He's such a great guy. He did Outside Providence and Federal Hill and all those great... Anyway, we
gifted
really
man.
Miss him.
A gifted man.
Very gifted, and we miss him in this area tremendously.
And we had Jane Hansen who was going to call in.
We liked Jane, too.
Exactly.
She had to go to a funeral, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's why I had Hansen when you walked in. Anyway.
It's all fine.
You guys, it's been so much fun, though, and you and I are getting together. We're doing game night.
I can't wait.
I can't wait either. We're going to try and postpone them from leaving to Florida.
I can wait.
Exactly.
Yeah. I can wait.
Yeah, well, you're not as excited.
I bomb at games.
You do?
No, come on. Look at my IQ. You think I play these games? Jane's playing Scrabble. She says, can you see a word here? Once I got a word.
I drive everybody crazy because I literally first thing in the morning, I have to do the New York crossword puzzle.
Oh,
I mean,
God.
I'm
the same way.
Do you play Mahjong?
No, I don't. I don't know how.
Oh, I could teach you in such a little time.
Oh, okay. My God. This is dangerous.
Yeah,
oh,
I don't know if you should go to Florida so soon.
Oh, my.
You should
look at
wait
the time.
Till January. That's when we all go.
You know what? I'll come back
Okay. There you go. See? All right, Bill.
Bill Boggs, thank you so much.
We're closing out with Elvis.
Okay.
You're welcome.
You're going to tell us a story.
Lady Jane, thank you.
I like to say, instead of no problem, you are welcome. No problem is replaced. You're welcome.
Right.
Anyway, all right, Elvis Presley. As a 13-year-old back in 1956, I was mesmerized by Elvis. And believe it or not, my beloved mother went all the way down to the arena in West Philadelphia and bought two tickets. And my sister and I, on a school night, saw Elvis Presley. With the original Jordanaires.
Oh.
First rock show I ever saw was the Big E. And then I saw Elvis at the Spectrum in 71. He was great. Then I saw him again in 75, the night I met Sinatra. And he was glassy-eyed. Frank wanted to know, how's Elvis? And I said, something's wrong with Elvis. And he said, I'm concerned too. Anyway, I want to go to 1968. Elvis's so-called comeback special. This song, If I Could Dream, Elvis wanted to know if he could still seem relevant. And he commissioned this song because this is the year that Martin Luther King was killed.
Yeah.
Bobby Kennedy was killed.
Yeah.
America's in complete turmoil. And so Elvis commissioned what I think is a brilliant song, and he concluded the special with this meaningful song, which Colonel Tom Parker did not want him to do. He didn't want him to do anything that touched of politics. But Elvis... push that aside. And this is also how I close out my stage show, Voices of Our Time, when I talk about great singers and I show clips of interviews from the YouTube channel. So this is Elvis laying out the goods about If He Could Dream.
If He Could Dream, and you'll come back and see us.
Thank you, Bill.
Please.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Lady Jane.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What a pleasure.
Thank you. Going out with Elvis.
Biggie.
listening to Jessica Ambrose and Bill Evans. It's Lunch on the Deck on 92.1 WLNG, Sag Harbor, New York. WLNG.
Winston Groom, author of Forrest Gump, says that Bill Boggs and his friend Spike the Wonder Dog unleash comedic wizardry in this madcap, highly entertaining satiric novel. Spike is the newest canine literary hero to take on the world with hilarious results.